Golf Central on YouTube, brought to you by TaylorMade.
It in the hole.
Yes, sir. Gets it. Huge.
And that is one heck of an afternoon for Europe.
In 2018, it was Team Europe at Le Golf National taking back the Ryder Cup from the United States in convincing fashion. And while this week would have been Ryder Cup week at Whistling Straits, the countdown is officially on for 1 year from now in the 2021 Ryder Cup in Wisconsin. The European Ryder Cup team will be made up of the top four players on the European points list, followed by the leading five players from the world points list. Captain Padraig Harrington will also make three captain's picks. Qualification process currently frozen until January 1st, 2021. All points earned from the BMW PGA Championship of 2019. Until play was paused in March, those will continue to count. On the American side, all points earned since qualification began in 2019 will continue to count towards the 2021 team. The selection process will run through the second leg of the FedEx Cup playoffs at the 2021 BMW Championship. Top six in points auto-qualify, while U.S. Captain Steve Stricker will pick the remaining six players after next year's Tour Championship. So the question they were grappling with, if you hold a Ryder Cup with no one there to cheer or jeer, like we could have had this week in Wisconsin, could you even call it a Ryder Cup? Welcome into Golf Central. I'm George Savarikas. Clearly, the PGA of America, the European Tour, the potential players and captains all thought delaying it from 2020 to 2021 was the right call. Earlier today, our Mark Rolfin caught up with U.S. Captain Steve Stricker to discuss how they're preparing for the 2021 Ryder Cup.
Exactly a year ago today that you and I were in the locker room at Whistling Straits talking about the Ryder Cup. When you look back on the last year, does it seem like kind of a short time during that span, or does it seem like a really long time to you?
Yeah, good question. It seems like a really long time. I mean, and I think everybody would say that, you know, for what this country and the world has gone through with this pandemic and the quarantine periods and the no golf for a period of 3 months and then now playing golf, it seems like a whole heck of a lot has happened in this year. And it's nice to see that we're playing golf and getting through without too many cases, and the U.S. Open was just played, which was fun. And but it's it's a lot has happened. A lot of crazy stuff has happened with the, you know, political unrest too, with the Black Lives Movement and all that. You know, it's just, it's been a lot going on, and the year is gone by pretty slowly in my mind.
You're one of the few guys that I've heard say the U.S. Open week was fun. You and I were both there at Winged Foot. In retrospect now, what would it have been like going to Whistling Straits on Monday a couple of days ago, right after a grueling like that week like that at Winged Foot? Would that have been difficult, do you think?
Yeah, I think it would have been very difficult. Hindsight, you know, as we were talking earlier, Mark, that I think this is a blessing that our guys are not playing this week. You know, it was an extremely grueling week. I was there, played only a couple of rounds, but it was enough for me. It was very tiring. I'm sure a lot of guys were pretty fatigued at the end of the week. And it would have been a tough turnaround to get prepared and ready for the Ryder Cup. So I think all in all, putting it off, being able to hopefully have the full fan experience next year at this time, it's all going to be worth it.
Talking about a grueling week, the stretch of golf that we have in the next year is going to be pretty epic with all the major championships kind of lining up. And of course, the FedEx Cup, we have the Olympics in there. It is going to be an unprecedented stretch of golf. Are you concerned at all about how the players that are going to make the Ryder Cup are going to be able to manage that time and still have some gas in the tank for Whistling Straits?
Yeah, that's always the concern. And both teams have to worry about that, right? Not just our side, but the European side as well. They do a lot of traveling across the Atlantic coming over to play on our side. And so they got to worry about that as well. But our guys, you know, they're smart about that. They make sure that they are ready to play. They're rested. They work out now, the majority of them. They keep themselves in great shape. They eat good, sleep well. So they'll do their best to manage their time. They know it's going to be a busy year. And, you know, it's just, it's the life that it is on tour. And you have to take care of yourself and make sure that you're ready to go play when that week, and especially the Ryder Cup week, is going to happen. So I've got the faith and trust in my guys that they'll take care of themselves and be ready to play, especially for the Ryder Cup, because it's such a big deal for us and our guys, and we want to win. And so they'll be ready.
You talked about the fan experience and wanting to have the whole fan experience at Whistling Straits. What kind of an impact did no spectators at Wingfoot have on you? Did that make you really sort of reinforce the thought that you wanted the full fan experience for the Ryder Cup?
Yeah, very much so. I'm one of those guys that I've struggled playing with no fans. We played a champions event in Sanford a couple weeks ago, and having the fans there was incredible. It was such a different experience than the last couple months playing on tour. And then you go to the U.S. Open and you're playing a major championship, but with no fans. It just doesn't have that same energy, that same feel of a major championship. You know it's something special when you're there, but it's just not the same. And the Ryder Cup, if we went to had fans, it would have been extremely difficult for our guys, I think, all guys, you know, to put on a show that they're accustomed to putting on during a Ryder Cup. And I'm sure it would have been good, but it's nothing like having the fans. The fans make that event. They get so involved in the competition, the chants, the cheers, the songs. It just provides so much to that event. And without the fans, it wouldn't have been much of an event, in my opinion.
A year ago today, we thought we were 1 year from the Ryder Cup. Today, we're still 1 year from the Ryder Cup. How much attention are you paying to the shape that your team is taking? Do you give that much credence right now? Are you starting to see how your team is taking shape?
For sure. I'm watching all the time, you know, and putting these scenarios in my mind of possible pairings, seeing Bryson play well, seeing Matthew Wolff play well again, some younger players, Colin Morikawa playing well at the PGA and winning there. This team could really take on a different shape in another year's time. So, yeah, I'm watching and you know, taking notes and paying attention as much as I can. And fortunately, I got another year of being a captain, probably the longest tenure of any captain in history, I guess. So I got that going for me, but it'll be fun. It gets me playing on the regular tour again for another year to be out there with those guys to see and be up close and to meet some of these guys. Like, I've never met Colin Morikawa or spent any time with him. So I had a practice round with him at the PGA. And so I have that opportunity as the year goes on, and for sure, I'll be watching a lot of golf and paying attention to these possible scenarios that we may have going forward.
All right, you brought up the two names, so I didn't have to, Bryson DeChambeau and Matthew Wolff. As you take a look at the likelihood of them being on your team and the way they play the game, is that going to have an impact at all for you on the way you would like to see Whistling Straits play in the Ryder Cup, given their style of play and what they showed us in New York?
Yeah, we made some adjustments last fall to the course to kind of favor our team, I guess. And each team has that ability to do, you know, and we did that last year. So, and it won't change from here going forward. And I'll probably sneak up there either this fall or next spring again, just to see how that's come along. But from what I understand, some of the things that we've done to the course, they came in great, and I'm excited to see them. So, but from here on out, we won't change anything. I think we had good dialogue and the setup was good from a year ago, so we won't need to really change that going forward.
Thanks for joining us today, Steve, and enjoy the longest Ryder Cup captaincy tenure in history that you got going right now.
I appreciate it, Ralph. Take care, buddy.
Look at the recent results in the Ryder Cup. It's been a completely one-sided affair with Team Europe winning four of the last five. But if you dig deeper into the numbers, the home team has won four of the last five. The only outlier, 2012 at Medina when Team Europe came back from down 10-6 in Sunday singles play. It just shows you how big an advantage it is to play on your home soil. European Ryder Cup captain Padraig Harrington spoke with our friends at Sky Sports earlier discussing the Ryder Cup shifting to 2021.
At the start of this pandemic in March and April, we were working behind the scenes to get plan B in operation, you know, to get a way of picking. Obviously, by the time May came around, there was a lot of difficulties, like, and it was becoming inevitable that this thing was going to be postponed. But there was stress and pressure waiting for that. But when it got postponed, it was a relief. And since then, I haven't thought about it at all up until last week. When I was tweeted out about it and saying that, well, who would you pick? Because I was sitting down looking at who I would have picked at this time, not for next year, for this year. And obviously, just out of curiosity, I was wondering who would have made the team this year. And obviously, you know, outside of that, really, I haven't thought about much. And I won't for the next couple of months either. You know, I'll keep an eye on who's playing and who's playing well. But come January, when the points start again, we'll get back into it. We've a full, you know, 8.5 months of qualifying there to pick a team. And it should give us a good balance, which this year we couldn't have done it. We just couldn't have figured out how to pick a team.
Joined now by Golf Channel analyst Tripp Eisenhower. Tripp, interesting to hear Padraig Harrington kind of crowdsourcing what the hypothetical Team Europe could have looked like. On the American side, it would have been odd to think maybe Tiger could have been a captain's pick, but nothing would have been guaranteed. But next year, as you project forward, it could be a Ryder Cup that doesn't involve them in a playing capacity.
It really could, and I definitely would say that more about Mickelson than I would Tiger. I you know, the year that Phil's had, we've seen him do with his game, he's going to have to select his spots. He's going to have to pick majors where he's going to be able to play, you know, competitively to rack up enough points to gain attention of the captain, Steve Stricker. But the problem that Steve Stricker's got is there's no dearth of young talent. I mean, the PGA Tour is filled with it on the American side, and so is the European Tour. I mean, you've got Rasmus Højgaard, who's just been on a tear recently in Europe, and you've got Victor Hovland, who would be an addition for Padraig Harrington. Yeah. But the old guard of Phil and Tiger, to your point, on the U.S. team, that certainly looks like that would be in jeopardy, because I don't know if he wouldn't have – Phil probably's best chance of being on a Ryder Cup ever again would have been for a pick this year, and I don't think Steve would have picked him based on form. You can't
– It would have been hard to.
It would have been easy to justify leaving him off a team at this point. Now, we'll have to see, but next year I think Phil's going to have to play his way into that top six. I really do. If he does play his way into the next six, yes, I'll be fair, Steve would give him a pick just because of the gravitas he brings to the team,
sure.
Not only on the golf course but in the locker room and all the intangibles that he can help the young guys along with. But again, you got to put guys out there that can get points for you, and that's really what it's about. Now, Tiger's another one that if we look at him –
What do you think the metric would be for Tiger to have to be a captain's pick if he's outside the top six? How far down?
I think it would be when he does play, he shows form like we've seen. I mean, look, we saw it at Zozo. He's going to be defending probably the next two times we see him. He's going to be defending. So it's not like he hasn't won. It's just, can he get up for those big events? And you know, he didn't show that at the U.S. Open, probably from a lack of reps, if you will. And that's just one of the things that we see from Tiger Woods. We'll have to see how he plays in those times he does play, because we're not going to probably see him a whole lot. So I don't think he'll play his way on.
From a couple guys where the hourglass is trending in the wrong direction to the youth on
right.
the PGA Tour,
yeah.
you touched on. Who are some of the new faces that could really comprise the building blocks that we look at, not just for 2021, but maybe the next decade going forward?
Certainly Bryson DeChambeau. I mean, Steve mentioned, but he's going to be on the team.
Yeah.
I don't think there's any question about it. He's going to play.
Barring injury or something unforeseen.
But Matthew Wolff, he's played two majors. He's got two top fours, okay, in his first two majors ever. And by the way, Colin Morikawa, I think Colin Morikawa has the ability to have a long run of Ryder Cups, President's Cups. He's going to be a stalwart of those teams for a long, long time. And he's a guy I would be very, very confident about putting out there and not worrying about him losing points. He's going to be gaining points. I don't think he's going to be that intimidated at the Ryder Cup with his game.
I would love to see Wolf and Hovland, opposite sides, former college teammates, going head-to-head. That would be quite
I would get the
showdown.
Popcorn for that.